Welcome to Daniel Reviews. I'm Daniel Goodwin. Today we are going to attempt to answer one of the biggest questions that comes up when you're first starting your solar journey, and that is, how much battery capacity do I need in order to run my house in the event of an outage? Let's get into it. I got to say up front, there are a lot of variables that's going to impact this equation, and depending on your use case, you may need tremendously more than what I need, or vice versa. And a lot of things are going to be impacted by the climate you live in, whether you use natural gas along with electricity, whether you're all electricity, the size of your home. Just a lot of things are going to impact this equation. And, you know, I hate to say this, but I have to say it. No matter how much you think you need, you're going to need more. For this video, I'm going to reference my home, which is, I live in Iowa. It's a cold climate, maybe not as far north as some of the others. But what that means is in the winter months, I call that December to early March, my solar production is a lot less, and the needs of my house are a lot higher than they are in, say, spring or fall. So that's going to impact a lot. The overall size of my house is just around, total square footage is about 3,000 square feet. So I think it's about average, maybe a little bit larger, not as large as some. And it is an old house, which is not particularly well insulated or well ventilated for the HVAC system. So there's definitely some things that we're battling against that makes it not exactly an energy efficient home. The first thing we're going to talk about is the size of your main panel. Depending on the age and construction of your home, you're likely going to either have, if you have an older home like I do, 100 amp service or 100 amp panel, or if you have a newer construction, you're likely going to have a 200 amp panel. Both of these are very important to answering the first question about how much solar and battery power you need to run your home, is to take a look at that main panel. Since I have a 100 amp panel, if just a few equations here. I promise there won't be too much math. If every circuit in my house was single phase at 110 volts, then that means that the maximum output of my panel would be around 11 kilowatts, 11,000 watts, right? Now, if every circuit in my house was 220, then the output of my main panel, 100 amps, would be about 22,000 watts or 22 kilowatts. Now, obviously, not every circuit is single phase and not every circuit is split phase. It's kind of mixed. And so for my house, that means that my output, maximum output, is probably somewhere between 15 to 18 kilowatts. And that's if I went, turned on the AC, ran it at max, turned on the oven, turned on the dryer, turned on the cooktop, turned on the microwave, turned on everything and ran it full bore, then probably my household consumption would peak at somewhere around like that 15 to 18 kilowatts, give or take. Now that's obviously just running everything full bore, which you don't do, but if you need, that's the first piece of information you need, is how much of a power output do I need for my house, 100 amps? I'm gonna need somewhere in that 15 to 18 kilowatts. So that's the first thing I'm gonna target, is I need a system that can output up to a max of, let's call it 18 kilowatts. That means that the Ecoflow Delta Pro Ultra with a smart home panel, three of those would easily cover it. The EG4 18 kilowatt inverter controller, that would cover it. There's a lot of numbers, but you could take the EG4 6 kilowatts and parallel them, that would cover it. But it lets you know what like capacity of it, or not capacity, output you need to target first. That's the first question you need to answer. Why is that important? Well, because if you don't get the right size system, you are going to have a moment where you're turning on lots of high energy use circuits. And if your selected system doesn't have the ability to output that much, it will, you know, it'll fail gracefully and switch over to grid power. But otherwise, you could have a power outage or something. So you want to choose a system that's going to be able to provide the max output that your house needs. If you have a 200 amp panel and you have a lot of high energy use circuits, then you're going to need a higher output. You're going to probably need somewhere in the 25 to 30 kilowatt output. Now that's maximum output, which I grant you is not realistic. You're not always running all those appliances at all the same time. So that's that. We don't want to take that as the base case. We're just saying what output do I need to be able to accommodate? And then you can talk about what is your average daily household use. Now, if you have something like the Ecoflow Smart Home Panel or the Span Smart Panel, they will give you a lot of metrics on your house so you can figure that out yourself. Otherwise, it's going to be a bit tedious going to each circuit, putting in maybe a watt meter a measurement, figuring out what is the average draw, and then trying to figure all this out on your own. You can do it. It's just a lot of math and, you know, measuring. My daily average use varies widely depending on what season we're in. So you can see, I'll try to put this up here, spring and fall, my use is pretty low, I think pretty low, and that's mainly because I'm not using the AC and I'm not using the heat pump. So mostly my energy use is just, you know, my single phase circuits, the lights, the you know, the maybe run an occasional microwave or something like that. Of course, running the electric dryer, just kind of the internal fan in the furnace. Those sort of things will be running, but not anything heavily intensive. So spring and summer, you know, looking at my average use, it's pretty light. And I don't necessarily need a lot of capacity to handle spring and fall. Summer and winter are the real challenges, right? Let's talk about summer first, because summer is actually not as bad as it, you know, you might think. You might think, okay, you're running your AC, you're running, you know, very high energy intensive thing, which it can be true depending on your AC unit. But the good thing about summer is when your house is needing that energy is usually midday to afternoon, which is when you got peak solar production. So it's offsetting a lot of that use during the summer months. So, you know, it's just taking it, almost passing it straight through from the panels to your air conditioning or whatever, fans, whatever you got going on. And then it only starts tapping the battery after, you know, the sun goes down, and it's, thankfully the temperature usually drops accordingly, so your AC isn't working quite as hard overnight, which means it's not drawing quite as much energy. So the summer months actually very doable, even though it's a pretty high average daily use. Winter, at least in Iowa, is where we really get hammered. And the problem with that is you're running a heat pump, in our case, a heat pump, which is kind of like running your air conditioner at full blast. And so while it's, you know, it's somewhat energy efficient, it's a huge energy draw, right? And the worst part about it is the need for it is greatest when the sun is not up, right? Not during the midday and afternoon. It's needed at night and early morning, which you have no solar production. So it's all tapping directly out of your battery bank or the grid if you're connected. So winter is where it really gets brutal, because yeah, you can get some sun usually during the, you know, the day to top those batteries up a little bit, but at night it's really pulling hard, and that's why you need massive amount of storage. So you look at my home's energy use, particularly this is January, to really cover everything, single phase, split phase, the whole works, I probably would need about 100 kilowatts of battery capacity in order to not tap the grid. That's just for one day. So, you know, if the next day I'm not getting enough solar production to bring those batteries up, which it'd be pretty hard to bring a 100 kilowatt bank all the way up to full again, I'm going to be tapping the grid. So, if you're thinking, how much do I need to be completely energy independent? Well, if you're in a cold climate like Iowa, you're going to need a lot, because more than likely you're not going to be able to recharge that battery bank, that big of a battery bank, and your household use is going to stay pretty heavy. You would probably need, you'd need to multiply that out probably by a factor of 5. So now I would say to truly never need to touch the grid, you'd probably need, like, for my house, again, in Iowa, I'd probably need a 500 kilowatt hour battery bank, which is massive, hugely expensive, obviously. That is just a tremendous amount of storage. But you got to factor in there's days where we get no solar production, or we get snow and there's no solar production, or whatever. So you got to take all those factors into consideration. So with all that said, let's talk about some things that are important. There are a number of energy hogs in your house that if you can be careful and use them prudently or not at all, you can greatly reduce the footprint of your household energy. And I'm just going to go through them quickly. You got your AC/heat pump if you have one. You have a wall oven if it's electric. You have a cooktop or range if it's electric. You have an electric dryer. Usually those are very high-powered electric resistant heating. You have microwaves. And then if you have a space heater, a small heater, that is deceptively high wattage use. All of those things can absolutely evaporate your battery bank. You can cut down a lot of your energy use by using natural gas appliances, a lot of your electric use, I should say. However, that's not really solving anything. It's just you're using one form of power production. You're exchanging one for another, right? So if you did a natural gas dryer, you did a furnace for your heating instead of a heat pump. If you did a gas cooktop, gas oven, all of that would drastically reduce your electric usage, but obviously you're going to be using a lot of natural gas, so which is more expensive, usually, depending on your rates. So I'm not sure that I'm not recommending that. I'm just saying those are some trade-offs that if you went that route, then you wouldn't have quite as high energy use, or electric use, so you could have a longer backup time on your battery bank. But just be aware you're making a trade-off there. And of course, you're still going to be dependent on some other form of production, whether it's a propane tanks or natural gas delivery through your utility provider. So in conclusion, for my house, in order to mostly power my house completely independent of the grid on most days, I would recommend about 100 kilowatt hour battery bank of storage. And that would allow me to self-power my house most days. I would guess somewhere around 280 days out of the year here in Iowa. Basically the winter months, there's no way I see that happening. You might get an occasional day when it's not super cold and that you can power your house entirely off a battery. But just because of the way that dynamics work, where your house needs the energy most at night, you're gonna be tapping out your battery banks, and you're probably not gonna be replenishing it all the way up during the day, even if you do get good solar production, which the whole month of December was basically you get nothing here in Iowa. So what I'm saying is 100 kilowatt is something I would target, but I'd also be realistic in saying, look, there's going to be probably 3 to 4 months out of the year where I simply cannot power my house, even though I have this pretty massive battery bank. Now, if you're in Florida, Arizona, someplace where you get consistent sun and maybe you don't have quite the extremes and need the heating as much at night, your equation may change considerably. But I think this is kind of a good average across America, just because where I'm located and size of the house that I have in the system, probably going to need about 100 kilowatt to get mostly self-sufficient. Now, if you have a smaller house, reduced energy profile, things change. But the main thing I want you to be aware of is it's always much bigger than you would think, much bigger.